All right, so we should get going, I guess, while this working with vessels. I'm going to overlap a little bit to what Paul said, but I hope that I will bring you some more simple and examples of how you get to do your first use with the vessel if you haven't already. So, and this is sort of aimed a little bit to using vessels for debugging. And what I mean by that is visual debugging. When you have like a geometrical problem of some kind, you're analyzing your neighborhood from your snapper or something, and you want to know some geometrical information about that, because, you know, tracing geometrical stuff is not that great. So then vessels is one way to do that, and I'll show you a little bit how you can do it. But I will also talk a little bit about what they are. So, as you know, we have these, you know, fundamental entities of core. We have the animation, snapper, connector, singularity, and now we have vessel as well. So I will say that that's on the same level as these basic concepts. So a vessel is something that can exist on its own, or it can be a part of a snapper or animation, and it can be transferred around, as you heard. And it can do anything. But what I'm focusing on is that it can produce 2D and 3D, so you can generate graphics with it. It has position and rotation, and it is data-driven, or it's a bit data-driven. You can subclass vessels and have them do what you want, but the sort of foundation for it, yes.
Aren't they also, if I recall correctly, I haven't actually worked with the last conference, are they non-streamable?
Non-streamable, well, so that doesn't mean that they're not declared as unstreamable, right? But we typically don't stream them. So if you attach a bunch of vessels to your snapper and save your drawing, those will not be saved. That is the default behavior. So be a little bit careful if you're going to put, you know, state into vessels. Then you have to think a little bit about how you manage that state. How do you save it? How do you handle undo, for instance? So I would suggest if you're new to vessels, stick with them, using them for, you know, modifications, temporary objects. Exactly. So when you load the drawing, you could create your vessels then, but you will probably have to have the state somewhere else if they're depending on some kind of states. So data-driven might be an exaggeration, but the vessels are very prepared for handling properties and, you know, tags. They can be controlled by tags or can be tagged, and tagging can mean almost anything as well. So we'll look a little bit into that. Already said this. And as you probably know by now, reducing code duplication is one of the sort of key things about them, that you can reuse them in different places. You don't have to implement the same thing in multiple places. So because the vessel can be used from any from animation or from a snapper and so on, you can have the same code and throw in the vessel. I mean, you can do that with a function as well. You can have a function that produces 3D, and you can call that from your animation or from your snapper, and that will also work. This is just another way of doing it. So. The vessels have an active concept, which is mostly meaning that it's visible. It can be interpreted in other ways, if you like. And there are, for the visitors, there are usually an option, I would say, that visit only active, this door, so you can turn this on and off. I wanted to show you this more because of how it's implemented here. So there is no field called active in the vessel. It handles it by tags instead. So if you put this tag into tags, then it's considered active. So it's just another way of representing stuff. So, as CJ said, vessels are not only animations that if you have vessels on them, the animation will actually show the graphics from the vessels without any kind of modification. If you put vessels on a snapper, you will need to do something like this to if you want to show the 3D from the vessel. And worth noting here is that in this case, as you know, the 3D from the snapper is produced in snapper coordinates, so it means that the vessel 3D must also be produced in sort of local coordinates. It will end up in the snapper coordinate system, so the vessel need to be aware about that in this case, or you know, have a oh well, all right, you understand what I mean. So, and maybe as opposed to that, space vessels will, of course, exist in space coordinates. So, a space vessel sort of exists on its own. So you can add a vessel to space and it will show. And it can do operations on anything. Get more into this. So you can use a vessel as an information carrier. Since this can be transferred around, it can contain information. I've not done that myself, really, so but it's possible. The thing I have used vessels for is only for, well, for graphics and for user interaction. I'll show you that. Yeah, and it can be made to reusable code, of course, and go into the graphics debugging thing. So I'll do a little bit of a demo. I think you have already, well, many of you have probably seen this before, but oh yeah, I have to exit that. Go into this. This is that. Consumer, the kitchen consumer version. So, which is, you know, it looks a little bit different, but it's like CT Designer. You have your view and you have your snappers and like that. It's not that different. But this is a vessel, the blue graphics here. And we create it or update it at select hook, I think, and show it for the current snapper, which we assume is a kitchen snapper in this case. So we only do it for kitchen snaps, I believe. If I click a wall here, I can. Oh, it doesn't show on the walls anyway. You can ignore those graphic glitches. It's part of the surface graphics card. So this vessel can not only show some graphics, but it can also do actions. So we have this. If I click this here, it will now it's selected the group, and if I click here, it's selected the single snapper again. So, and if I click here on the cross, it removes it. So. That's just an example of how you can build your vessel to do some user interaction. You get these events to it, like selected and clicked and whatnot. Let me see here. So we'll
go back to this.
A real good thing about the vessels are that you can easily just throw them in there on your animation. So if you have an animation, like at least if you're using the new animations, I'm not sure how it works if you're extending from like the old animations. But if you have a tool animation G2 at least, this will work on right from the start. So you can just add these vessels to any animation. I will show you. Go back into. Test animation. I'll try to make this a little bit bigger. So this is just an animation, and as you can see, it doesn't contain anything yet. It's just an animation, and it doesn't do anything. So, and I have this on my other this little green dot here. Now it started and running, and it doesn't show anything. Okay, so. So we'll just do this, we'll throw in a vessel in it, like that, vessel around pulse. And we'll, there it is. So now we get this kind of graphics here, and it will, yeah, the actual, I mean, since it is a tool animation, it will still find a candidate snapper to sort of pick, you know, so that's why it's snapping to stuff here. That's not the vessel, that's the tool animation doing that. But the vessel is producing the graphics. And you can have some more graphics, remove that and add these, red cross and red frame. Now. Yeah, this. So it's in 2D and 3D, you get a, you know, some kind of graphic. And if you define this somewhere in your extension, you can reuse it for all your animations, and by that you can change your highlighting for your entire customization in only one place, for instance. That's really good. But it's also very easy if you have an animation with no graphics and you don't really know what it's pointing at. You can add the graphics. I'll show a couple of more just to show that it's easy to do different things. This is using the material override. So now we're, you know, highlighting in a different way. And actually, I found out that you don't even have to call update vessels here. Maybe it's because we're already in a tool animation D2. Yeah. Yeah. So I'll turn it on to be correct here, like that. But it's really, as you can see, it's really, really one-liners just to get some graphics out there. Sure. The outline, or what do we want to see? We'll go there. So, let me see. This is pretty short, but I guess this is what's doing the actual work here. What is this? Yeah. Okay. So there's a vessel for overriding materials, and then 2D and 3D, and then those. We have some. Yeah, well. Okay. Okay. We'll backtrack a little bit. So this is the other one on Red Cross. It has a get 3D, which is using, I guess this is some old get 3D, right? Like a function, and it's not much else here. So where does it get its position from? Is it? Okay, so we'll do this instead. So going back here, I can show you the highlight vessel functionality. I guess it's a space vessel or a set of space vessels. Okay. So if I do this, I can highlight all the snowman snappers. Here. Is that correct? Those are like one space vessel per snapper for this?
They're all in space, yeah.
Yeah.
The snappers don't call 3D by default, so that
would. Yeah, yeah. So this is just one way if you want to, you know, find all snappers of a certain class or something like that. Maybe you're just debugging something or looking for, you know, where the problem is, but you can't actually find the snapper in the drawing. That can be like a visual tool for that. You can do clear, and you can highlight them like that. That will give another color. Worth noting it is that if you run this a few times like that, it will sort of stack those on top of each other. So now we have like three layers of frames around the snappers. So it's a good idea to once in a while, you know, clear them off. Otherwise the colors get a little bit off and you get a lot of triangles. So that's really easy to do. And of course you can do this from your animation when you're searching over candidates or something and want to highlight those, which one on the drawing did I actually visit, or which one were my candidates. And I have an example of that too. So I did this for the snowman here. It now has a read-only quick property, which is called friends. And when I click it here, it will actually scan its surroundings and count how many other snowmen there are around it in a 3 meter area or something like that. Just have some kind of neighbor or surrounding analysis at click. which is pretty unusual, I think. But I have a real life example of it also. I'll show you later. So anyway, if I want to know which ones they were, because it's not working for some reason, I think it's wrong here. It shouldn't be two or something. You can go into Snowman and have this. Okay, so here's my count friends implementation. Oh, I'm gonna get this bigger so you can see it. So we go to space and get some snappers with the snapper filter for Snowman, and then we iterate over the candidates to make sure that the actual distance between the center points of these snappers are less than 3 meters. And if it is, okay, we have a friend, and otherwise we remove it from that set. And that's, I wouldn't need the remove from set really if I didn't wanted to show them, which comes in here. So here I will do the same clear all vessel highlights we did before. I will put the left snapper candidate in a sequence, just because highlight snappers need a sequence instead of a set. And I will call this here. So I can go, let's remove that too. So now if we click one here, no, or not, did it recompile? Okay, so this guy has these two friends, and to make it a little bit more clear, I added a red highlight as well to this only. So like that. And now it's pretty clear here what my surroundings are, or how the function actually works. I can see is it reasonable. I don't want this one to be highlighted over here, because then something with my code is wrong. So. And the good thing is that I can just throw this in here, right in the implementation of count friends. I don't need to, you know, go into my get3D method and transfer the state from some other function in a global or in a field in Snapper or whatever. I can just do it right here where my code is at. So I think that's pretty useful. I'll remove that and I'll go back to consumer version here, because here I have sort of a real life example of why I needed to do this. So in this simple consumer version, we want to help the end users a little bit more than in CD Designer. So we don't want them to be able to stretch cabinets through walls and into other cabinets and so on. So this up here is actually, you know, a replacement of the quick properties. And as you can see, you can select the width up to 80 there. If I take this one and make it a little bit smaller, I'll select this again. Now, as you can see, the width can go up to 100. So width at rebuild quick properties or at select, when I click that snapper, I will we do a surrounding analysis and checking for other racks that could collide if we stretch this to different widths. So that also needed some debugging, so I'll show you that. So we'll go back here. Okay, because this didn't work the first time I wrote it, of course. What does? So let's see here. I'll go into that branch and with stretch animation something here. So this is actually not a vessel here. This is a debug snapper, but this would be much better off being a vessel. So what I'm doing here is that when I analyze the surroundings for the cabinet that I'm going to click here, and I find the first larger width, because I'm iterating through all the widths to see if they are going to sort of fit in the drawing. And the first width I encounter that is not possible due to collision, I draw a debug graphics for that, so I can see it here. So I can see the shape, and it seems correct. It actually did intersect this other rack here, so that's good. I mean, to get some kind of visual feedback for that kind of algorithm is very, very useful. And also, I wanted to show it because if I were in the middle of an animation, if I was, you know, in the stretch animation here, I could easily have the stretch animation itself show some kind of debug graphics as well. But because I'm doing this on click here to populate the possible widths, I don't have an animation. I don't really want to add any graphics to this snapper just because of this. So space vessel here would be great. So, any questions at all? Because this is as much as I had for this presentation. What do you say, CJ? I think you're going to get our presentations as well. So hopefully there's some hints there, you know. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So how do you suppose you would handle the collision check if you had, say, a train?
Yeah, that would be more tricky. I guess a binary search would be the correct solution for it. But you seldom do. And actually, that was kind of I wasn't sure how to implement it because I didn't want to, you know, change the width of the snapper and have all its contents, you know, updated and so on for every step of this. So it's actually more of I extract the rectangle of it and manipulate the rectangle only in this case, which is not going to work if it was some kind of, you know, rounded snapper moving, stretching like this or something like that. That would be more complicated, but fortunately in kitchen most cabinets are just boxes, so that works. How many of you have used vessels at all? Yeah, a few. Yeah, you think you will? Yeah. I think doing it like this, like for debug graphics, is a good start anyway, because it's very simple and you don't break anything and it's not critical for your system or anything. You can start learning there, and then you can move on to maybe using them for your actual problems in your customizations. Anything else? I guess you will have a longer coffee break now.